What color is this? We could call it purple, but in the digital world there are far too many colors to name. Instead, we describe the color using numbers, usually a set of three numbers. All of these describe the same color, just in different color systems. It's like saying $100 is also 87 euros, which is also 138,751 won, or 14,895.25 yen. Each number represents the same value, just in a different unit. Currency conversions are straightforward. You just multiply by an exchange rate. But when dealing with vectors, which have packets of multiple values, changing units is more involved. If there are three values in a vector, like our colors, that could call for a change of up to three units. Instead of calling it unit conversion, it's called a change of basis. But the ideas are the same. We even still use multiplication for changing units in multiple dimensions, but it's a matrix multiplication instead. If you've ever wondered why we bother changing bases in linear algebra, or why we don't just stick with the standard basis, this video will give you a satisfying visual explanation, and we'll cover the step-by-step process for changing bases in an upcoming video. As many of you know, our channel is sponsored by Brigham Young University's Department of Mathematics Education and College of Computational, Mathematical, and Physical Sciences. We're now looking for other sponsors and donors to help support the students that work on this important project. Our mission is to share with the world how mathematics, statistics, and probability are used and can be used to understand the world around us. We especially hope that our content gets used by teachers and is seen by students. Although there are a lot of math and stats channels out there, very few focus on this particular area, and it's an area where students and parents say that school math is lacking the most. If you have extra money you would like to put to a good cause, you can donate to our channel through this website. Instructions on how to donate on the website are in the description. And if you're associated with a company or an institution that would like to partner with Math the World as a sponsor, please reach out to us by emailing mattheworld@byu.edu. Thank you so much. I hope you don't mind if I start with a little rant. When I first learned about change of basis in linear algebra, we did tons of problems like this, and they made no sense to me. Why wouldn't we just use the standard basis? It's the simplest to work with. My professor never explained why we'd bother to switch to a different basis. Maybe he mentioned eigenbases, but with no real-world context, it just felt like abstract math for mathematicians. Only later did I realize that change of basis shows up all over the place in really practical ways. Although you wouldn't know that for most YouTube videos on the subject. In my video search, I didn't see a real-world example until the 17th video in my search results. Some of these videos are fantastic with the what and how, just not so much on the why. These videos are a symptom of a much deeper problem in math education, teaching the how before the why. So in this video, we're going to flip that and give you the why through a few quick, relatable examples of where and why changing a basis actually matters. And in our next video, we'll cover the details of actually how to change bases. One way to think about a change of basis is as a change in coordinate system. The axes might stretch, rotate, or shear, but the underlying vectors stay the same. We just describe them differently. So when one coordinate system makes the math easier, we switch bases. For example, in 3D animation, placing the camera involves converting all object coordinates into camera coordinates, a new coordinate system, or basis, centered on the camera's position and direction. This helps determine what's visible and where it appears on screen, and smoothly rotating the camera requires many small basis changes. My favorite real-world example is the bird's eye view in modern cars. There's no overhead camera. The effect is created by merging views from several vehicle-mounted cameras. Each camera captures objects in its own coordinate system, and we transform those into a shared overhead system using a change of basis. I just think it's so cool that we can use math to see what the overhead camera would see, but we never really need one. One caveat to changing basis based on camera coordinates is that if the new coordinate system has a different origin, we use homogeneous coordinates, which we covered in a previous video, and it's linked below. Changing a basis is a powerful idea in data compression. Look at JPEG image compression. The standard basis does not work well here because the standard basis vectors tell us the intensity of each individual pixel, and dropping any one would create a hole in the image, which could be noticeable. Instead, they use these 8x8 blocks with different patterns to create each 8x8 block of the image. These can be used to create the image exactly, but some of these blocks contribute very little to the image, especially natural photographs. The blocks with small coefficients can be dropped and not make a noticeable difference in the image, and that means that there's less information to store or send. And if we're clever about how we choose the basis, then we can drop a lot of basis vectors and lose relatively little information. We actually did this in a previous video where we showed how to compress audio. The link to that is also in the description. Since sounds can be approximated well with waves, we picked basis vectors that were waves of different frequencies. We used 60 basis vectors to create audio that was indistinguishable from the original audio that required 1,200 standard basis vectors. Some contexts force us to change units and thus change bases. Technologies representing color being one of them. On screens, we use RGB, red, green, blue, because these match the three types of cones in our eyes. Each pixel typically has a red, blue, and two green lights, since our eyes are more sensitive to green. And by adjusting the intensity of each light, screens can produce a wide range of colors. But this model doesn't work well for printers. Mixing RGB light creates white light, but mixing RGB pigments tends to produce muddy darker colors. So printers use a different basis, cyan, magenta, yellow, which better mixes to create a full range of printed colors. Most printers also add K, which is black, to save ink, hence the CMYK model. So your screen needs input with one vector of three values for every pixel, but if you print the image on your screen, those colors need to be translated to CMY values or CMYK values. There are more than 10 color models that are currently or recently used. Each has its own benefit for why they use that model over others for their function. For many of these models, the conversion from one to another is a simple change of basis. But other conversions are nonlinear and cannot be done with a simple matrix multiplication. Sometimes a different basis can also provide insight and patterns in data that would be hard to get in another way. Our bodies vary in size and shape, so how do clothing manufacturers know how to design clothing to fit such a varied population? Well, even though we can take a lot of measurements with our body, the measurements tend to be highly correlated. Suppose we wanted to manufacture shirts, for example. We could make a shirt that matched up closely with each person's measurements, like shoulder width, neck size, chest size, waist size, bicep diameter, arm length, wrist diameter, etc. But that would require a huge store to keep a stock of shirts that could fit about anybody that walked through the door, and many of the shirts would never leave the shelf, contributing to very expensive shirts. But because these measurements tend to be highly correlated, we can save a lot of money by looking at the data. I found a dataset with body measurements of adult males and plotted neck, chest, and abdomen size in a 3D scatter plot. These three axes here could be considered the standard basis. They're based on the circumference of each body part in centimeters. But the most useful axis isn't one of these measurements alone, but a new axis that captures the covariation of the three measurements. This axis or direction here shows how the average body changes in a general scale that we might just call the size of adult males. Notice that the axis goes in a direction that's positive in all three standard axes. So as one of the values gets larger, so do the others on average. This new axis is what would guide shirts manufacturers' measurements on the patterns of their shirts. They would pick values along this line to represent various shirt sizes, small, medium, large, extra large, etc. So even though there's only one dimension now, the shirt designs change many aspects of the shirt to capture the general trend. But what if you don't like close to this line? This impacted me because I had a hard time finding dress shirts that would fit. I don't lie on this axis very well. My neck is skinny, but my shoulders and chest are quite broad, so any dress shirt that fit my arms and neck was quite tight across my back and shoulders. I learned that if I went up a size in the neck, then the shirt also gave me more room across the shoulders, because males with larger necks tend to have broader shoulders. But then the shirt didn't look as good because it was too loose around my neck. But we can fix this problem by varying shirts in another dimension. We can add a second axis that's perpendicular to the first, capturing the next direction that varies the most in body shape for people that are the same size, which are those that have the same value in the first dimension. This second axis is chosen to explain as much of the remaining spread in the data as possible, because this direction would help those that are off the initial axis the farthest, and thus help those that feel the most uncomfortable or unfashionable in the shirt. You can imagine the two directional axes as helping to fit shirts on a plane that slices through the data cloud, trying to fit the shape of the cloud more closely than just a line. Along with the main size dimension, the second axis allows for meaningful variation in shape. Now, shirt manufacturers can use this second axis to offer three versions of a shirt for a given size, one near the average body type, and two others shifted maybe one standard deviation in each direction along the axis. The second axis likely reflects shape differences rather than size. We can understand what it represents by looking at the direction vector in the line's equation. The first part gives a point on the line, and the second is a direction vector scaled by a parameter, lambda in this case, to reach any point along the line. The coefficients of this vector, ordered as neck, chest, and then abdomen, reveal how those measurements change together. If the neck and chest components are positive and the abdomen is negative, that means as we move in that direction, a person's neck and chest size increase, but their abdomen gets smaller, suggesting a lean, muscular build. The opposite direction, with smaller neck and chest but a larger abdomen, might represent a body shape with less muscle and more belly. So even when two people have the same size, captured by the first axis, their shape can differ significantly, and that's what the second dimension helps account for. That's why many clothing items have more than one size distinction on the label, like a size number and a fit type, such as short, regular, or tall for jackets, or slim, regular, and loose for other clothing. Changing the basis to describe the data allows fewer shirts to fit more people, keeping prices down. Our final example shows how changing a basis can make computations easier. In a previous video, we showed how matrices can be interpreted as a transformation. Although most transformation matrices are pretty complex, with rotations, shears, reflections, projections, or some combination of multiple transformations, a scaling transformation is really easy. It just has values down the diagonal, what we call a diagonal matrix. This is a very easy matrix form to work with. For example, powers of a scaling matrix can be easily raised to a power because multiplying the matrix by itself is the same as multiplying the diagonal entries by itself. So the 100th power is found by finding the 100th power of the diagonal entries. But the 100th power of a matrix like this takes a lot of computation. But if we describe the columns in this matrix with a different basis, it's a special basis that turns out to be the most important basis, and we'll dive into that later in another video, then we can turn this matrix into a scaling matrix, and taking powers is easy. It does mean we need to find a matrix that changes the original into the new scaling basis, and then after raising to our desired power, we convert back to the original basis through an inverse matrix. But the two extra multiplications to convert to a new basis and back by multiplying by P and P inverse are worth it, since it saves us so much computational complexity in raising a matrix to the 100th power. One application of raising a matrix to a large power like this is used to look at long-term behavior of systems, such as how animal populations and subpopulations change over time, or probabilities in Markov chain simulations, or predictions of inter-industry economic models and spreads of disease during epidemics. In our next video, we'll show you the details of how to actually convert between two bases. In the meantime, if you know of some cool contexts that use non-standard bases, leave them in the comments. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe and share our videos. Be sure to follow Math the World on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Thank you so much for your support.